fast as a cancel check. Your maximum point of power is now.
1990 was the year for change. It was about time. It was the beginning of a new decade.
We will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christianity.
Girl power.
Yeah. I've done a lot of the things that I wanted to do. I've led a good life.
Every day has the potential to make history, to be a beginning or an ending, to contain the moment that changes everything. This show is about the nine most important days in 90s music. Some of them are obvious.
Controversial rapper and actor Tupac Shakur has died in a Las Vegas hospital.
Some shocking, others you never would have circled at the time.
Here they are, Nirvana!
Yet by looking back, the dividing line becomes clear. Music started the day one way and ended the day another. In the next hour, you'll witness the moments that mattered most. You'll meet a so-called loser who sent a wake-up call to a generation, an artist who stormed the rock and roll boys club, and a hip-hop star who borrowed from the past to usher in a new age in pop music. Where were you when these 9 days rocked the world? December 22nd, 1993. Who? Michael Jackson, self-proclaimed King of Pop.
What?
Live international broadcast from Neverland Ranch responding to allegations that he is a child molester.
What happened?
America's obsession with the private lives of celebrities sparks a free-for-all between stars and media over who has the last word.
At the start of the 90s, the biggest star of the 80s, Michael Jackson, is known more for being a weirdo than for being an artist.
He's 40 years old. He's still doing the moonwalk occasionally, not in this country, but, you know, in Timbuktu or somewhere where he tours now.
Strange reports emanate from his Neverland Ranch. He lives inside his amusement park. He befriends monkeys and offers millions of dollars to buy the elephant man's bones. But one bit of Jackson news proves far more disturbing, the allegation that he molested a 13-year-old boy. In an unprecedented move, the normally soundbite-shy Jackson makes a live televised speech, appealing directly to the public in an attempt to gain sympathy for what he is going through.
I have been forced to submit to a dehumanizing and humiliating examination by the Santa Barbara County Sheriff Department and the Los Angeles Police Department earlier this week. They served a search warrant on me which allowed them to view and photograph my body, including my penis, my buttocks, my lower torso, thighs, and any other area that they wanted.
Jackson then lashes out at the very same media that helped vault him to superstardom.
I am particularly upset by the handling of this mass matter by the incredible, terrible mass media. At every opportunity, the media has dissected and manipulated these allegations to reach their own conclusions. I ask all of you to wait and hear the truth before you label or condemn me. Don't treat me like a criminal, because I am innocent.
The case is settled out of court for an undisclosed sum of money. Though no criminal charges are pressed, Jackson never regains his artistic credibility.
It's hard to listen to Michael Jackson's music without thinking of Michael Jackson the man, thinking of his legal difficulties, thinking of the kinds of image-altering things he's gone through.
He's the tragic ghost of our celebrity culture. He's the victim of our celebrity culture. He's also the monster of our celebrity culture.
Jackson's live statement marks a turning point in the way celebrities of the 90s approach scandal. Instead of answering reporters' questions, public figures, including the president, choose their favorite media outlet and tell their stories.
I must take complete responsibility for all my actions, both public and private. And that is why I'm speaking to you tonight.
What can I tell you? I was stupid. It was a stupid thing to do. I've never been able to turn down a free meal.
Heard any good jokes lately?
And the interest doesn't stop. Coverage of celebrity arrests and scandals grows, feeding the appetite of an ever-increasing number of media outlets. Along the way, just like Jackson, many bash the media for its zest in reporting celebrity news.
Legitimate news sources like the LA Times and Network News should draw a clear line in the sand. Do not purchase your news. Do not use tabloids as a source.
It is time to stop the pursuit of personal destruction and the prying into private lives.
November 23rd, 1992. Whitney Houston. What? Her video for I Will Always Love You from the Bodyguard soundtrack goes into heavy rotation on MTV. The soundtrack goes on to sell more than 18 million copies worldwide and stays at number one for 20 weeks.
What happens?
The success paves the way for film and music to synergize into a full-on marketing package. The 90s become the decade where music is the soundtrack for life.
One reason why the Bodyguard soundtrack was such a huge soundtrack is that you have to listen to that one song, I Will Always Love You, and hear Whitney Houston sort of hold that note near the end for that long, and you know, by the third or fourth second, you're like, okay, I'll buy the album, I give up.
You can mention the song to me, and I can hear it like that in a minute. It's sort of like remembering what your mom's lasagna smells like. It's one of those impact memories, you know? Sometimes we just wish it would go away.
It was horrible. Yeah. It chased you down the street. You'd duck into a bar and it'd be right behind you. It was just songs like that really get on your nerves after a while.
While soundtracks have been around a long time, the 90s see an unprecedented explosion of the format. Soundtracks are connected to television shows and even commercial vendors. But ultimately, it's the synergy between cinema and sound that's the most mutually beneficial.
It was largely the decade of soundtracks. You know, people went to the movie and expected to hear the song. You know, Celine Dion, obviously the classic example. A song that kept the feeling that people had about the movie alive in their heads on a daily basis.
People get into the movie and they see this tragedy and they see that love is even stronger than that. So they want to see the movie over and over again and want to hear the song because it's about love and it's very strong.
And I don't want the world to see me. I just want you to know who I am.
Look at that Goo Goo Dolls song, you know, from City of Angels. In and of itself, it wouldn't have touched people the way it did, but linked to a movie and to the subconscious memory that people have after they see the movie, it was a huge success.
You know, when you see yourself on a chart next to Whitney Houston, I always say to myself, well, you know, it's a nice neighborhood, I'm just driving through, but, you know, we don't live here.
I think movies use music almost in a sense to promote and market the movies. That's what I think it was. It was more of a marketing tool. There's not a soundtrack that you really have that you just listen to from beginning to end.
And someone discovered if we make a soundtrack that's got a bunch of pop songs on it, then we can get free commercials on MTV and promote, you know. And usually I think it kind of cheapens films to just throw songs of the moment in.
It filled the niche for an album of just cool tunes. Instead of maybe you don't want a whole album of Third Eye Blind, God knows I would understand that. But you can take the one song, which is really cool, and put it together with someone else's one cool song. So you get a lot of one hit, two hit wonders and put them together, and it's a compilation album.
By the end of the decade, some of those compilation albums are having longer lives on the music charts than their cinematic counterparts are having in theaters.
They seem to be another form of cross-marketing synergy, all those terms.
The way that the emotions of the movie and the song would ping-pong back and forth and just boost, you know, each other to greater and greater heights. Whitney Houston singing I Will Always Love You made it, a real presence in the 1990s.
Love you.
Hi, we're the cool kids. You might have seen us in the commercials they're playing all the time on MTV.
Yes.
America's number one condom, trusted for over 80 years. And by Salon Selectives. Go beyond hair that's just there to hair with style.
With Salon Selectives, you'll step out feeling beautiful.
Who's that lady?
Salon Selectives is the only line of customized products that lets you mix and match for fabulous hair that leaves you feeling beautiful.
Who's that lady? Who's that lady?
Salon Selectives, get out there and feel beautiful.
for red, dry eyes. Try Clear Eyes. It removes redness and has an ingredient to moisturize.
Wow.
The difference is clear. Clear Eyes.
Ma'am, may I please see your bag?
The syndicate is watching.
You know, I've played in the U.S. and Canada, so I've got friends all over. That's why I use 1010-220. It's only 99 cents up to 20 minutes and just 10 cents a minute after that within the U.S. or to Canada. So when I call my buddy Phelan here in the States, or my brother in Canada, it's just 99 cents all day, every day. With 1010-220, all your calls can be under a buck. Hey, little brother, go long. Falls for it every time.
Hey! Hey!
How do you stop a rhino from charging? How?
Travel with Joseph Van Ass Photo Safari to Kenya's land of the Maasai.
How do you stop a rhino from charging?
And you'll see a culture and a wildlife like no other on Earth.
How do you stop a rhino from charging?
But bring your Visa card.
How do you stop a rhino from charging?
Give it an American Express card.
Because this photo safari doesn't take American Express.
Wait till they hear this in Nairobi.
Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
We all want the same things. Clear skin, and clear skin. Well, big news. Unlike ordinary cleansers, Neutrogena Oil-Free Acne Wash gently cleanses deep down into pores to dig out dirt and oil, and helps get rid of the acne you have now. And, ta-da! Helps prevent future breakouts. Which may explain why dermatologists recommend it, why it's the number one acne-fighting cleanser, and why we should all use it. Neutrogena Oil-Free Acne Wash.
Fresh breath, making all local stops. Tic-tac, breathe friendly.
You're next.
It's WCWNWO Thunder, only on the PlayStation game console. Choose your competition, pick your weapon, and play Thunder till your thumbs bleed.
Feel my power with WCWNWO Thunder.
December 22nd, 1994.
Who?
Madonna.
What?
She signs former Canadian pop princess Alanis Morissette to her new label, Maverick Records.
What happens?
Morissette's Jagged Little Pill becomes the most successful album ever released by a solo female artist, proving that women in the music industry have real girl power.
I was writing in the studio one day, and my partner called and said that people at Maverick wanted to meet us. We played Perfect and You Oughta Know, and then left the office, and then within the next month, I was signing with them.
Are you a label, kind of label chief that actually monitors everything coming in?
I mean, nothing gets signed unless I listen to it.
Yeah.
There's a few things that have slipped through the cracks, but
really?
Not anymore. Those days are over. Madonna's signing of Alanis Morissette and behind-the-scenes power is precedent-setting.
Madonna showed that a woman does not need to be afraid of a younger female competitor. And Madonna probably wasn't thinking about being gracious when she signed Alanis. She was probably thinking about making money. And nonetheless, it had a great impact for that.
Jagged Little Pill sells over 28 million copies worldwide.
It's a phenomenon. It's fine. I'm glad that we've all made inroads so that Alanis can present a safe version of female rape. I don't care. I'm sorry.
A tide is turning. In 1996, history is made. Female solo artists outchart their male counterparts for the first time. Even independent recording artists benefit.
He says, call me Mr. Franco. There's anything I can do. I say it's Mr. Franco to you.
There weren't record companies, you know, pounding down my door, so I thought, well, I'll just start my own record company. I incorporated myself. I am a corporate, I'm a CEO, actually. I don't know if you could tell, but look at me. Then there's Missy Elliott.
Me, I'm super fly.
She was smart enough to not only make herself into a celebrity, but also to really make herself a powerhouse behind the scenes.
You don't want to have just one thing that you relying on, like just being an artist. Like, if the artist thing don't work for me, I still got my label. If the label thing don't work for me, I'm still a songwriter. Put your foot in everything that you can possibly put your foot in if that's what you gotta do.
Missy Elliott uses her behind-the-scenes muscle to get her face in front of the camera. Lauryn Hill does just the opposite. Her success as a vocalist gives her the clout she needs to get control behind the scenes.
Being a woman in the industry just is not very easy. The industry has a tendency to think that there's always some male puppet master, some puppeteer, you know, pulling the strings, and that women are just like, yeah. You know, and then all we do is diva. To this day, I don't know what that really means.
In 98, Hill takes a break from the Fugees and produces, writes, arranges, and performs on her first solo album. Even England's Prefab Five ride the wave of female empowerment to superstar status.
We like girl power, man!
The one thing that I like about the Spice Girls is the fact that I can say that I hate them and they probably won't care. That's the cool thing about them.
No, Spice Girls are kind of like heroin. You know somebody's doing it, but nobody admits it.
I think little girls adore them, and I think I was probably a Spice Girl-esque when I started out.
The Spice Girls were not musically important at all. It's all about that camaraderie, that, you know, we can do it all together. Their strength is and was in numbers.
Strength in numbers. In the wake of Alanis Morissette's success, Sarah McLachlan joins with other female artists to break through another boys' club barrier, the festival circuit.
Like me, like any of these other artists, none of us can go up in front of crowds of 22,000 people on our own. We don't have that draw, but together we do.
Lilith Fair gives female music fans a festival to own.
It was a truly astounding experience, because if you've been going to concerts, you know what it's like to be one of not that many girls. So to walk into an arena and just see more women than men was really a sea change in the way that live music could be experienced.
It just shows that the women of the 90s today are kind of overpowering now the music industry.
It's just something that we can come and say that women have accomplished something, and this is it, and this is how we can enjoy it.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everybody.
September 4th, 1997, Sean Puffy Combs unites on stage with Sting to perform I'll Be Missing You, a song built on a sample from Sting's Police hit Every Breath You Take. What happens? Samples cross over from one classic record to another in an artistic triumph of cut and paste culture.
Check it.
Hip-hop producer, and 80% of hip-hop records are sampled records. And I was there when it was born. It was a DJ with a beatbox machine sampling the record.
Hip-hop has always been a scavenger's art. It's always been a music where people take existing sounds, recontextualize them into another form.
We've been sampling records for, like, you know, going 15 years now. It's just really getting the notoriety and the criticism just due to the fact that the records are crossing over so big.
Stop. Hammer time!
I got a lot of different flavors working in this one. I call it Come With Me Part 2.
Come with me! Come with me again!
What a bereft of imagination. What a piece of crap. You know, come up with something your own.
Puffy isn't the first to face criticism. Problems start for sample-based artists early in the decade. Several find themselves in legal hot water with the original musicians of the sampled music.
people take what you've spent your hard-earned money creating in the studio and use it again for nothing.
Theft is not legal.
He goes ding, 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 diggy, ding, ding. Ours goes ding, 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 diggy, ding, ding. That little bitty ting. It's not the same.
On Monday, in a Manhattan civil court, Biz, real name Marcel Hall, lost a copyright infringement suit filed by Gilbert O'Sullivan. The case could have historic ramifications in the gray area of sampling law.
I like sampling. As long as I get paid, I never worry. That's what the late 20th century, in fact, is all about. It's juxtapositions of different information.
You can construct these really complicated mosaics out of samples. Although every single element may come from somewhere else, the combination is totally unique.
The range in which sampling has evolved as an art form, and the mad uses of it in different ways from Beck all the way around, that's a legitimate form of creativity now.
It's just part of the consciousness of music being made in general. It's gone beyond hip-hop or dance music. It's in top 40 songs.
It's postmodern, you know, for lack of a better phrase. And that's what collage is about. That's what a lot of commercials are about. That's an art of this age, and it speaks very profoundly to what we're about now.
I know if my son was here tonight, the first thing he would have done is say big up to Brooklyn.
He does pick the right memories to pull from. I mean, he does take songs and samples that conjure feelings that we need to have, apparently, because look how big the songs are.
Take hits from the 80s. But do it sound so crazy?
I have no shame as far as sampling records, because I like old records. I like giving them some life, making them new. And if that's what I go down in history for, you know, at least I go down in history for something.
Let's get it on! Just fool 99. I said let's get it on. Get it? Celebrity Deathmatch. No dirty stuff.
It's on.
I want a clean fight.
Come on now.
Who needs marching band? Get yourself a real halftime show. MTV.
Come on out of there, champ.
No.
Come on out of there now.
No.
Man, I ain't going out there to fight this guy, man.
Come on out of there.
Those pay-per-view people, they can just go find another sucker, because I ain't going out there.
Tommy, he's a changed man. He's had counseling.
I ain't going out there, man.
Eat me alive. I ain't going.
6 weeks of training. What, are you kidding me? You got nothing to worry about.
What you mean I ain't got nothing to worry about?
Not going anywhere for a while.
Everybody's waiting. You're hesitating. They can just find somebody else.
Grab a Snickers, because nothing handles your hunger better.
Come on out of there.
Hungry? Why wait?
I left my heart, and that's my song. And I've sung for kings and queens and 7 American presidents. It's wonderful to have everybody recognize you. Will shine for me.
Beautiful, Mr. Bennett. But if you're going to write a check for these CDs, I still need to see some ID.
Use the Visa card that automatically deducts from your checking account at the millions of places Visa's accept.
I left my ID in
San Francisco.
The Visa check card. Works like a check, only better.
Ian thinks you're hot.
No way.
Way.
He told me in home room.
The syndicate is watching.
Son, I think we need to talk.
Uh-huh. Oh, no. Not the heart-to-heart. Not now.
You're acting a little
odd.
Odd, yeah.
Uh-huh. Look, just leave a pamphlet on the table and I'll read it after
it's
breakfast.
It's about responsibility.
Man, all I want to do is eat. What does he want me to say?
So, do we have an understanding?
Uh-huh.
Kellogg's Corn Pop cereal is part of this complete breakfast.
I think we really got through to him.
Gotta have my pops.
Your way, it just tastes better.
Get ready to shake up
be a winner.
The system.
Do you want whipped cream?
Varsity Blues.
That's better than football.
Rated R. Now playing in theaters everywhere.
Before severe weather strikes, prepare with Project Safeside.
Crippling ice storms, heavy snows, severe winter weather can be devastating. Don't let your guard down. Prepare a family disaster supplies kit and keep it handy. Stay indoors if you can and keep posted on developing weather conditions.
Project Safeside. From the Weather Channel and the American Red Cross.
You can advertise in the newspaper, but your message may not get delivered. You can advertise on the radio, but what you say may not be heard. But if you really want to reach out and grab them, take them to the edge and watch your business soar. Advertise on local cable on the Sci-Fi Channel.
There is no other destination.
Together, we'll deliver.
Imagine a place where all the shows you know and love come together. It could only happen in TV Land. 24 hours a day of classic TV favorites. How do you get there? Call your cable or satellite company. Your calls make a difference. Tell them you want the basic cable channel that loves TV. Tell them, take me to TV Land. Take me to TV Land.
July 18th, 1991.
Who?
Barry Farrell of Jane's Addiction.
What?
Creates in headlines the first Lollapalooza.
What happens?
Music fans go crazy for festivals where the audience is the star and youth culture tribes come together.
One, two, three, four!
It's not just simply music, but music can bring about people to come together. And the same with my festivals. They're built on one principle. I want to create paradise on earth.
Here we go!
Lollapalooza is like paradise on earth to a new audience with a fresh take on the concert-going experience.
Well, I guess what I found inspiring about the first Lollapalooza was that there was more than just bands. It was the kind of beginnings of some kind of alternative culture, something that you can participate in and express your tribal allegiances through.
It's a way for everybody to come together, you know, show that we can all get along.
Everybody come out, be free.
I think it's rad because I like the mix of different bands.
I think it's rad. It's just like a big party.
It's rad.
And the audience is incredible.
Doesn't it seem cool to walk around? Doesn't it seem like, wow, this is like Wonderland?
Rejecting the corporate sponsorship that had become commonplace in the 80s, Lala invites political activist groups to put up a table and spread their message.
I think just because an issue isn't on the your local or national news every night doesn't necessarily mean it's an issue that young people won't care about, won't rally to, if the issues involved are presented to them in a very clear and direct fashion.
We're here to rock for choice.
Sign our petition!
Authentic Lollapalooza ticket.
You're not going to school today. Today, your classroom will be the Capital City Amphitheater. Your teacher, 4 dozen rock bands.
Ripped out. It's terribly in. It was the best time of my life.
Someone over at the Crafts Fair said when it comes to Woodstock 94, love is free and everything else is going to cost you.
Woodstock is trendy enough to feature that definitive 90s tribal rite, a rave.
Well, I think raves started because you had these events that were like warehouse parties where maybe 1,000 people would come, and people realized that the more people came, the better the vibe was. And I think they also answered a kind of social need that people felt for being part of a crowd.
I mean, the sun's coming up, there's really good music playing, you're with all your friends, you know, and so that can make it like somewhat of a spiritual experience.
Lala appears to run out of gas by 96, the Beastie Boys pick up the torch for the Activist Festival with their series of Tibetan Freedom Concerts.
I think a lot of young people, when they become aware of the situation, will become more interested in it. They just need to be able to focus it at something.
Music, politics, other stuff. Whatever the reason, 90s festivals give a generation hooked on individuality a cool space to come together.
You're not going there to judge some musician. You're going there to party, and you've got great background music to do it to.
June 6th, 1990. Two Live Crew. What? The band's album, As Nasty As They Wanna Be, is ruled obscene by a U.S. district judge in Broward County, Florida.
What happens?
After the controversy, their album goes on to sell millions of copies, demonstrating that in the 90s, it can pay to be.
Who would ever think that here in the United States of America, we will be telling grown people what they can purchase and what they can't purchase.
Members of a rap group have been arrested for singing lyrics a judge has ruled obscene.
No one, in my opinion, has ever produced an obscene record album except for this one album by one rap group, and that's why I've gone after them.
Because of cases like this and pressure from such interest groups as PMRC, the record industry voluntarily creates a new warning sticker.
The advisories that you see here to assist record buyers, especially parents, in identifying material that may contain explicit lyrics.
Others join the fight to keep music clean. Even Walmart, America's number one retail chain, joins the struggle in defining what is obscene. It goes so far as to request artists to alter their lyrics and the cover art of certain albums before they can be sold in their stores. But the crusade backfires.
The dirty version is platinum and the clean version is not even close to gold. So that goes to tell you what the people actually want to see and what they want to hear.
It coerces, influences, encourages, and motivates our youth to commit violent behavior.
If you don't quit, yeah. If you don't stop, yeah. I'm letting my gat pop, cause it's 187 on an undercover car.
I don't consider myself no gangster or nothing like that. I'm in here to make money.
Putting her money where her mouth is, Tucker and other stockholders in Time Warner forced the company to drop top gangster rap distributor Interscope Records. But Interscope's Death Row Records goes on to sell over 25 million albums.
We will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christian morality.
Necessarily expect people to understand everything that I have to say. The things that I do that are provocative should piss people off.
Damn, y'all right.
God has given everybody a free will, and they have the will to choose to do what they want to do, but in the end, they're going to pay the price.
If they're going to have an atmosphere here that praises Satan, we're going to lift Jesus higher.
Synergistically, the Christian right and Marilyn Manson needed each other, you know? They each helped them in their careers. They each spawned outrage.
It happens again at Ozfest, where on June 15, 1997, New Jersey state authorities try to single out Manson and stop him from playing. But the shock rocker's attorney prepares a civil rights lawsuit. The state backs down, and the Antichrist plays.
I think it was necessary for us to set a precedent by pursuing this legally so that we would have a right to play the show. Not only was Marilyn Manson in jeopardy, but also rock music in general and the Constitution of the United States.
Throughout the 90s, artists push the envelope and controversial media grows more and more successful. The result, increased levels of acceptance for new forms of freedom of expression, even though the motivation is not always so pure.
The censorship became entirely a marketing strategy in the 1990s. It was just used to foment controversy. It was a way to break through the noise.
Fire!
doing when if what we're doing when if what we're doing when if.
Come on out of there, champ.
No.
Come on out of there now.
No.
Man, I ain't going out there to fight this guy, man.
Come on out of there.
Those pay-per-view people, they can just go find another sucker, because I ain't going out there.
Tommy, he's a changed man. He's had counseling.
I ain't going out there, man.
Now, eat me alive. I ain't going.
6 weeks of training. What, are you kidding me? You got nothing to worry about.
What you mean I ain't got nothing to worry about?
Not going anywhere for a while.
Everybody's waiting. You're hesitating. They can just find somebody else.
Grab a Snickers, because nothing handles your hunger better.
Come on out of there.
Hungry? Why wait?
Son, what you have inside is beautiful. So why be hiding your real taste behind that diet label?
Stop living a lie!
Diet Dr. Pepper tastes more like regular. That's our story, and we're sticking to it.
With Clairol's Herbal Essences Body Wash, you'll use any excuse to take a shower. The natural herbs and botanicals in pure mountain water. The moisturizing lather, the silky smooth skin. Never has getting clean been this much fun. Herbal Essences Body Wash. Drop everything and get it.
Do you know how to drive? How to say, hey, that's a foul in Japanese? Do you know where in the heavens to find a human voice? Where in your soul to find character?
One, two, three, one.
Do you know the shortest distance to a college degree is a straight line called discipline? Do you know how to walk it? Be all you can be.
Just once, I'd like to make something really great.
Amanda Shelton was looking for some magic in her life. Now, she's about to discover...
Everything you're feeling is going into her food.
She has the power...
We're floating.
Make it stop.
...to make romance come alive.
My friend Nolan told me this thing about men and sex.
Sarah Michelle Gellar.
That when they think about it, they play with their belts.
Sean Patrick Flannery.
That's ridiculous.
Simply Irresistible. Rated PG-13. Friday only in theaters.
Son, I think we need to talk.
Uh-huh. Oh, no. Not the heart-to-heart. Not now.
I'm acting a little...
odd.
Odd, yeah.
Uh-huh. Look, just leave a pamphlet on the table and I'll read it after
it's
breakfast.
It's about responsibility.
Man, all I want to do is eat. What does he want me to say?
So, do we have an understanding?
Uh-huh.
Oh. Kellogg's Corn Pop cereal is part of this complete breakfast.
I think we really got through to him.
Gotta have my pops.
Lima lava, where are you? With a love oh so true. A girl to hold in my arms and know the magic of her charms.
You never know when love might come true, so be ready with Scope. Nothing kills more bad breath germs. Its minty tingle gets breath Scope clean and fresh. Scope, feel the tingle.
Where are you?
Killer outfit. Too bad the nightlife sucks. Dracula returns to Castlevania on Nintendo 64 from Konami.
I want my baby back, chili, baby back, chili, baby back, real. Back. I want my baby,
chili, baby back, real. I got my baby back, real.
This is your opportunity. I don't want your life.
Get ready to shake up the system.
Woo!
Varsity Blues.
In the spirit of football.
Rated R. Now playing in theaters everywhere.
So you love the first behind-the-scenes Real World tape? Now's your chance to see more of the Seattle and Boston Real World cast like you've never seen them before.
Can I get your naked ass?
And don't forget the Seattle hipster hecklers.
Go back to Jersey!
Go home, Real World!
These breasts are growing very nicely.
So pick up the second installment of MTV's Real World You Never Saw, Boston and Seattle. It's got behind-the-scenes action, bloopers, and never-before-seen footage. The Real World You Never Saw, Boston and Seattle style. Available at these fine stores.
Three.
August 23rd, 1991,
who?
Kurt Cobain, Chris Novoselic,
Dave Grohl,
Nirvana,
a little-known grunge band from outside Seattle.
What?
The group takes the stage at England's Reading Music Festival a month before their album Nevermind is released.
What happens?
Nirvana captures and inspires a profound change in youth culture. It even smells like revolution.
Well, it was incredible. To be asked to go on tour by a band like Sonic Youth was like a dream come true.
Kim, Pete, Thurston,
you guys were really neat.
You know, it was like, wow, what an honor, you know?
Oh, it was insane. It was one big drunken blur is what it was. We were the opening band, so we only had to play for 40 minutes a night. God, it was just a nutty tour.
One of the first shows we played with them was at the Reading Festival.
We have a special guest. He's an interpretive dancer.
We were booked in clubs that held maybe 400 or 500 people. If that, some of the places held 60 or 70 people.
And to walk out on stage in front of that many people and to realize that that many people like this kind of music, it was just like, wow, where have we been?
No reason!
It was almost a revolution in a way, you know? There was just a feeling in the air, you know? There was just like this new thing happening and no one could quite pinpoint it, but we knew that we were a part of it, you know?
You couldn't deny the power of that music.
The intensity, the power. It was just an amazing experience.
People who could look up and say, wow, I've been waiting for this for years and years, and finally, here it is. When they came together, they were more than the sum of their parts. Dave was a phenomenal drummer, and you know, Chris is a great, great bass player. And they were led by a guy who was a wonderful singer, a great guitar player. And that was just one of those magic moments.
What's wrong with a band that has good music, like Sonic Youth or Dinosaur Jr., to be readily available to people to buy, like totally promoted, instead of most of the garbage that's out there?
The Reading Festival helped make grunge happen.
The corporate ogres prevailed, as we are a testimony to that.
It was the great coming out party of underground rock. Woo!
Ow, you broke my arm!
Hey, f*** you, man!
Everyone sensed that the album was going to do pretty well.
You could tell, like, you know, then and then you'd go into Teen Spirit. And
the nicest thing about that tour was that we weren't aware of our stardom. You know, we just got reports every once in a while, you know, hey, you guys are on the top 40, you know.
You guys are doing pretty good. You guys are getting played on these stations where they don't regularly play you.
You know, we didn't even believe people for a long time, you know.
The whole thing was such a phenomenon. People would call up and request, so they couldn't deny it.
It wasn't until we got back to the States, you know, I turned on MTV and there we were.
Because I used to room with Kurt, and I'd be sitting there watching TV. I see Kurt's face on TV. And I look over at the bed next to me, and I see Kurt's face, and it's just like, this is bizarre. It was weird.
The second Nirvana album captured a moment, a certain angst, and said a lot about youth in post-Reagan America, a certain kind of alienation.
Kurt Cobain meant a lot to kids because of the emotion that he had in his voice. The pain that he was going through was a pain that a lot of kids went through.
I think he was the closest that his generation came to a John Lennon in that, you know, he was writing very much from the heart, very directly, and he didn't play according to the rules. And Nirvana came at a time when the rules were strangling the music. I think they just blew the 80s nonsense apart.
Cobain and and Tupac. They are the, to me, emblematic artists of the early 90s because of their profound connection with the audience that loved them, spoke very specifically to their concerns and their frustrations and their aggression. But both were very vulnerable people inside, and in a way both were heading toward a kind of death that they foreshadowed in their work, where Cobain literally killed himself. Tupac created an environment of dramatized life that led someone to shoot him.
September 7th, 1996. Who? Tupac Shakur.
We're almost there. We're almost there.
What? Tupac is shot four times in a drive-by. He dies 6 days later.
Stop CPR. Everybody clear?
What happened? Tupac's death, followed by the murder of Biggie Smalls, sounds the final bell in gangster rap's half-decade domination of hip-hop and marks the end of a G thing. California.
September 4th, 1996. Tupac arrives at the MTV Video Music Awards in New York City, surrounded by bodyguards and carrying a walkie-talkie, ready for the kind of trouble that will soon end his life.
They see us and they want drama, we gonna definitely bring it like only Death Row could bring it.
Out on bail, fresh out of jail, California dreaming. Soon as I step on the scene, I'm hearing Hoochie screaming, fiending for money and alcohol, the life of a West Side player with cows die and it's wrong.
Tupac stands at the top of his game. The success of his first Death Row release, All Eyes on Me, has made him the best-selling rapper in America. Just 3 days after the awards, Tupac and others attack an L.A. gang member in a hotel lobby after a Mike Tyson fight in Las Vegas. Believed to be in response to an earlier assault against someone affiliated with Death Row, the attack will land Death Row head Suge Knight in jail, and according to some police reports, lead to Tupac being shot less than 3 hours later.
I think the most important moment of the 90s is the moment when whoever it was unloaded his gun into the car that was carrying Tupac Shakur and Suge Knight. Because depending on how you look at it, that was either the untimely snuffing out of a life that could have gone in a number of directions or the logical end of gangster rap.
You are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
We just telling it like it is, not holding back. It's like being an underground reporter.
The particular things we identify with quote-unquote gangster rap, which is, you know, automatic weapons, the crack dealer, the dope man as an icon, all of these things are products of the introduction of crack as a mass market commodity in inner city communities around the country. You have people with no jobs, you have a very poor educational system, and the competition for this trade became very intense because everyone could see how much money you could make very quickly doing this. So then the guns begin coming in. Gangster rap really did start as reporting. I mean, it really wrote about stuff that actually people saw. As it evolved, it became a kind of theater.
So Dre, what up,
dog? In 1992, Dr. Dre releases The Chronic, which sells 4 million copies and establishes gangster rap as a lucrative form of pop music. March 5th, 1997. Biggie Smalls is in California to promote his soon-to-be-released album, Life After Death. Smalls, a former crack dealer, has long been aware of the possibility of being shot and killed due to his close ties to the streets and his success.
I think about that every day. Every day it's real. That's how real it is. I think somebody's trying to kill me. I'll be waking up paranoid. I'll be really scared.
He is also concerned that someone will retaliate against him, believing, as Tupac did, that he was involved in Tupac's New York shooting in 1994.
He said in one of his songs, he knows you sent somebody to shoot him that first time. Why? Is that true or false?
Why? No, it's false. Why would I do that? I just want to let everybody know that I'm here. You know what I'm saying? I ain't going nowhere.
You You can't take their deaths in a way out of the deaths of lots of other young people who died. The tragedy of their lives is a tragedy of all the kids who were murdered in drug-related activities throughout the 90s.
With anything with death in your family, the hip-hop generation is a family. It makes you mature quicker. A lot of the dumb and stupid things that maybe the hip-hop culture would have done before, I don't think they'll do now as a respect for these people's lives.
Tyson, Holyfield. Martin Lopez.
We're not going to chew your ear off telling you how exciting Death Bowl 99 is going to be. We'll just say that the Battle of the Bulge is on. The rest is up to you. Watch it during halftime of the big game.
9 days that rock the 90s on MTV is brought to you by Trojan Brand Latex Condoms, America's number one condom, trusted for over 80 years. And by Salon Selectives. Go beyond hair that's just there to hair with style.
With Salon Selectives, you'll step out feeling beautiful.
Who's that lady? Who's that lady? Lovely lady. Who's that lady? Real fine lady. Who's that lady?
Because Salon Selectives is the only line of customized products that lets you mix and match for fabulous hair that leaves you feeling beautiful.
Who's that lady? Who's
that lady? Salon Selectives. Get out there and feel beautiful.
Honey, you can't go around dressed like diet. You taste too good.
You're making a darn fool of yourself in that diet can.
Time's up.
Diet Dr. Pepper tastes more like regular. That's our story, and we're sticking to it.
A friend in need, a friend indeed. A friend is bad.
Without You, I'm Nothing. The new album from Placebo. Placebo. On sale now.
I was stranded. I wanted a pad. Jamie only had tampons.
Playtex Gentle Glide.
Like, this is gonna be comfortable. And Jamie says, and those bulky pads are? No more pads for me.
Playtex Gentle Glide tampons.
So comfortable, you can't even feel them.
There's a time to obey.
We do things around here my way. You understand that?
And then there's a time to cut loose.
That's better than football.
Can I have your autograph right here?
Varsity Blues, rated R. Now playing in theaters everywhere.
Hi, I'm Dave Shimkus. Well, it's official now. Michael Jordan has announced his retirement from basketball. And right now, Short Shopping is bringing you this Home Shopping Network television exclusive so you can have a part of history. What you'll get, a 23-card box set. Every card oversized at 3.5 by 5 inches. 13 of the cards are pulled from the Living Legend set to celebrate each of his professional seasons. 8 cards are magazine covers that Michael's been on over the seasons. Card number 22... all of Michael's career highlights, from the Olympic gold medals all the way through to the 6 championships, every series final, he was named the MVP. And card number 23 with his back as he walks off the court. Call right now, toll free, 1-877-4-TV-SHOP to order your exclusive Michael Jordan retirement 23-card set for just $19.85. That's 1-877-4-TV-SHOP. Order now because this is not yet available in stores.
I'm John Norris with an MTV News Brief. DMX, whose second album, Flesh of My Flesh, Blood of My Blood, continues to hover in Billboard's top 10, was in attendance on Tuesday along with Jay-Z, Method Man, and Redman at a press conference announcing the launch of the Hard Knock Life tour. DMX released 2 full albums in 98, It's Dark and Hell is Hot in May, and Flesh of My Flesh in December. Both debuted at number 1. And he just completed filming videos for his upcoming singles, Slippin' and No Love. He'll hit the road with Jay-Z and friends February 27th in Charlotte, North Carolina. That is the news for now. More news at 10 to the hour every hour right here on MTV.
November 9th, 1993.
Who?
Beck Hansen.
What?
His song Loser makes its premiere spin on LA's alternative rock station, KROQ.
What happens?
Almost overnight, the song is adopted by the media as a Generation X anthem. Loser helps usher in the culture of irony.
I remember when Loser came out in 93 and I was supposed to be some slacker type entity.
You know, I guess we're gonna show the Loser video now for a lot of people to enjoy, and I was just
right on.
Cut it.
There was so much negativity just thrown my way. My real problem was that a song like this could sum up how a whole age group feels. You know, I think that the idea of that is ludicrous.
It did provide the media with like a really cool, rather pat little soundbite about Generation X and how defeated they were.
Defeatism is a reflection of the times. Dark and brooding music tops the charts, and a recession means few job opportunities for 20-somethings. All of this feeds into the media's misperception of a generation and its reluctant poster boy, Beck.
I think it was like along the lines with, you know, the Dobie Gillis beatnik, what people thought a beatnik was. The slacker thing felt the same way.
So what are you up to?
Same old, just lollygagging around, still unemployed.
There's always been slackers, you know? I mean, Kerouac was a slacker, you know? I mean, the modernists, some of them were slackers. No generation likes the terms that are applied to them. The hippies didn't like being called hippies, you know? The punks didn't like being called punks. So, who likes labels, right?
Lazy, apathetic, and unmotivated are just some of the other descriptions of the 45 million people born between 1965 and 1977. A group raised on pop culture, Reaganomics, and television.
Be quiet, you idiot.
Let's run in Stimpy. They're way existential.
They're also characterized by fractured families and short attention spans. All of this contributes to low expectations, fierce individualism, and an ironic worldview.
Oh, as if!
Generation X was supposed to be like very ironical, kind of grown up on TV and saturated with pop culture.
We're not worthy! We're not worthy!
That sort of alternative nation concept that seemed to pervade the whole culture, you know. You know, irony and self-referential stuff.
Irony. It's a noun. It's when something is ironic. It's, well, I can't really define irony, but I know when I see it.
Real irony occurs on November 3rd, 1992. That's when the so-called slackers get off the couch, get politically motivated, and vote in record numbers.
I will invest in this country in ways that will create millions of new jobs.
When Clinton came in, you know, we had a chance to make some paper, and I just think we took full advantage of the opportunity. The economy was looking up. We were pressed up against a wall, you know. And we had to come out fighting.
We look to you and know that you are no generation of slackers, but instead a generation of doers.
By the second half of the 90s, skate punks grab cell phones, video clerks become film directors, and computer geeks transform into computer moguls. The slackers become the leaders of a new age of opportunity.
The secret story of the slacker is that the slacker wasn't really slacking all the time. The slacker was actually, by doing what he or she wanted to do with her day, was actually starting sometimes to do what he or she wanted to do with her life. And it's not surprising to me that some of those people who were working in cafes in 1992 are running their own companies in 1998 and will be on into the millennium.
People I knew who you would consider slackers were just people who, you know, didn't want to go work in some horrible office for 40 hours a week and not have a life and you know, make just enough money to be miserable and not enjoy themselves.
People see decades in these big schematic lumps. I see decades as halves.
It is almost like two, you know, the decade was in two halves. The first half of the 90s was pretty much shattered by this tremendous economic recession.
I don't get the sense right now in America in the late 90s, kids have the same sense of limited expectations.
The more industrious slackers are the ones out there making money. And it seems like a contradiction, the industrious slacker, but it's not. It's a natural evolution, I think.
The whole quote-unquote slacker thing is, you know, that's kind of been kicked in the ass, you know. We're doing our thing. It's Generation X. We may have started off slow, but we got everything in perspective, and we're going to go down in history as some of the biggest movers and shakers of all time.